off. Or at least that's what would have happened if I didn't have Vivint. Instead, here's what really happened. Thief walked up, my Vivint camera detected him, scared him, and he ran away. My Vivint security system doesn't just record crime, it actually prevents it with a flashing red light and a whistle. And the best part is, I can check in on my home from anywhere right from my phone, whether I'm at the gym or the office, thanks to Vivint, all is well. If you want a system professionally installed, fit with the best cameras and 24/7 monitoring, call Vivint today. 833-420-4070 for a free quote and lock in free installation and a free month of monitoring service. Vivint, smart security professionally installed. Call 833-420-4070 to get started today. Offer valid for new customers only. System purchase requires monthly service agreement and equipment package. Speak to a Vivint representative today for complete equipment, services, and financing details. Visit Vivint.com for license. Information, other terms and conditions may apply.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, U.S. Tax Shield can help you take back control. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Our team of tax attorneys can stop collections and get you protected. U.S. Tax Shield offers a price protection guaranteed quote to get you protected today. U.S. Tax Shield is A-plus rated with the BBB, so call 800-466-9625. U.S. Tax Shield, 800-466-9625.
Paid for by Bar Justice.
Attention all women who have been diagnosed with ovarian cancer. Johnson & Johnson's baby powder and shower-to-shower talcum products have been linked to ovarian cancer. In February and May 2016, Johnson & Johnson was ordered to pay $72 million and $55 million by two juries to two women who contracted ovarian cancer after years of using talcum baby powder products. If you or a family member has been diagnosed with ovarian cancer and used talcum powder prior to the diagnosis, call Talcum Powder Help Now today at 800-831-6155. You may be entitled to substantial compensation. The consultation is free and you'll pay nothing unless there is a recovery in your favor. Don't fight this alone. If you or a loved one used talcum baby powder-based products before being diagnosed or died from ovarian cancer, call Talcum Powder Help now at 800-831-6155. 800-831-6155. 800-831-6155.
Attention all authors. Page Publishing is looking for authors. Have you written a book and want to get it published? Page Publishing will get your book into bookstores and for sale online at Amazon, Apple iTunes, and other outlets. They handle all aspects of the publishing process for you. Printing, cover art, publicity, copyright, and editing. Call 800-501-3689 now for your free author submission kit. That's 800-501-3689 for your free author submission kit. Again, 800-501-3689.
Real Country Radio is now on FM in the Beacon Newburgh area. Listen at 96.5 FM.
I saw your eyes begin to glow, and I could tell you once were lovers. You ain't had nothing that I don't know. Still upset you. that tears can't drown and makeup can't disguise. Now that old flame might not be stronger, but it's been burning longer than any spark I might have started in your eyes. Tears can't drown and makeup can't disguise. Now that old flame.
Here's Alabama with Old Flame. It's Real Country, Cactus Dave. How you doing? Thanks for having your radio on, and hope all is well with you on National Irish Coffee Day today. It's also National Bubble Wrap Day. Here's Matt Still on Real Country.
It's a big old world outside this little town. Thought that's all I needed to drown you out. It was gonna be easy. It was supposed to be easy. Put some days, put some miles in the rear view. A few state lines between me and you. Just a little space and time and I'd be fine. I've been from Savannah to Long Beach, trying to keep your memory out of reach. But there you were in the Delta night, Santa Fe sun, the Colorado sky. I could add another pushpin to the map, but that don't stop me from missing you. But looking back, guess it's just one place I haven't gone. I've moved everywhere but on. Going to mama's house, cause I'm still long gone trying to figure out who I am without you, and why I still think about you. Just biding my time, making ends meet, loading trucks, pouring coffee, pouring concrete, planning my next move, getting over you. Yeah, I've been from Savannah to Long Beach, trying to keep your memory. There you were in the Delta night, Santa Fe sun, Colorado sky. I could add another pushpin to the map, but that don't stop me from missing you. But looking back, guess it's just one place I haven't gone. Fix me up somehow. Wouldn't let me home by now. I've been from Savannah to Long Beach, trying to keep your memory out of reach. But there you were in the Delta night, Santa Fe sun, the Colorado sky. I could add another pushpin to the map, but that don't stop me from missing you. Looking back, guess it's just one place I have.
Your friends to listen here for classic country favorites.
Here drinking, trying to keep her thinking I'm a boozing my troubles away. But now I couldn't make her stay. Well, doggone her anyway. She can't say that I didn't try. Pour me another one, I'm finished with the other one. I'm drinking my baby goodbye. Every time we
disagree. She was always asking me, are you a man or a mouse? Now that she's gone, she probably thinks that I'm home, just a moving around the house. She probably thinks that she's the one thing I just couldn't get along without. Well, wouldn't it surprise her? I gotta sympathize her as long as these bottles hold out.
Well, I'm sitting on the bar stool, acting like a darn fool. That's what I'm doing today. And I'm sitting here drinking, trying to keep from thinking I'm losing my troubles away. And I couldn't make her stay. Well, doggone her anyway. She can't say that I didn't try. Pour me another one. I'm finished with the other one. I'm drinking my baby goodbye. Try to sit down and talk to her, it always ends up in a fuss. I try to reason with her right up till the time that she got on that Greyhound bus. It'd be better if I could forget her, cause she sure forgot about me. And if it takes all night, I'm gonna do it right. I'm gonna sit here till I can't see.
Well, I'm sitting on the bar stool, acting like a darn fool. That's what I'm doing today.
And I'm sitting here drinking, trying to keep from thinking I'm losing my troubles away.
But I couldn't make her stay. Well, doggone her anyway. She can't say that I didn't try.
Pour me another one. I'm finished with the other one. I'm drinking my baby goodbye.
Good morning. You're now listening to Kingston Community Radio, airing on FM 92.5 and AM 920 WGHQ in Kingston, New York. This programming is brought to you by our listeners and corporate underwriters who are interested in presenting local community radio. The opinions expressed on this program do not represent those of PAML Broadcasting or Kingston Community Radio. Listeners are encouraged to send in $10 per month to help bring this program to you, and mail your contributions to Kingston Community Radio, Post Office Box 4364, Kingston, New York, 12402. For more information or to donate online, visit our website at mykcr.org. And good morning. This is Dan Gatiss, and thank you for tuning in. A wonderful Monday today. Maybe we'll call it Wonder Monday. And January 25th, 34 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And weather and forecast for Kingston and the surrounding areas. Mostly sunny today, a high of 34. Tonight, mostly cloudy with a 21 low. And Tuesday's a 90% chance of snow with a high of 29, 1 to 3 inches expected. And Tuesday night, same, 70% chance of light snow in the evening with snow showers continuing overnight with a 1 to 3 inch expectation. Low 28. Wednesday, mainly cloudy, with snow showers around in the morning, 50% chance, and a high of 37. And then Wednesday night, mainly cloudy with a low around 25. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
Central Hudson reminds you, when it comes to your home's wiring, safety matters. Overheated electric cords or outlets are signs of inadequate wiring, within your wall, in an appliance, or both. Circuit breakers or fuses that trip often is usually a sign that a circuit is overloaded, an appliance is faulty, or something is wrong that can shock a person or cause a fire. Have a trained electrician troubleshoot such problems immediately.
We are Lions. We bring hope where it's needed. We are a global force for good. Support causes that matter. Change lives. Change communities. Change the world. We can do more together than we can alone. Join in. Experience the joy of serving. Be part of the movement. Give back. Let's unite the world for good. We are Lions. You can be too. Visit weserve.org.
Hi, this is Diane Eastwick from Athens, New York, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
Thank you for being with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ, 920 on your AM dial, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. And KCR's Talk Radio, 331-9255 is our call-in number for listeners. And let's get going. Tony Marmo is in the on-air studio. Fran DePetrillo Savoca is on the line, and we are ready to go. Welcome.
Rock and roll. Good morning. It's a Monday. Dan, I'm thinking, good morning, Fran.
Good morning.
How are you?
How is everybody?
What's that?
How is everyone?
Everyone is just chipper on a Monday.
I'm trying to pull up YouTube so I can see you.
Oh, I have a, I don't know what color the sweater is. What would you say, coral? I have no idea. Coral? No.
Green coral.
Green coral. I think it's not pink coral,
but it's green coral.
It's green coral, yeah. But so, Fran, there was never a name for your show with Laverne. I mean, Lorraine. It could have been Laverne and Shirley. I mean,
oh, there you are. We never came up with a real name.
Oh, we got to come up with a name for this duet.
That's true. Yeah,
it's about time, right?
It's about time. I know you started out on Fridays, and now you're...
Oh, right. Now we're Mondays.
Now you're Mondays.
Oh. Okay, okay.
I have a great M. I have a great M for Monday.
What's M? What M?
Marvelous Monday.
It could be a marvelous It's Monday. Always a marvelous Monday.
It's a marvelous Monday.
A Marvy Monday.
Marvy
Monday. A Marvy Monday.
So, Fran, how is it going in your world?
Everything is good. How's everything in good. Your world?
Oh, my world is great. I picked up my skis from Potter Brothers on yesterday and a new pair of downhill skis. And Dan was telling me that there's some snow in the forecast.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, coming in on Tuesday, 90% chance. Sounds like a pretty decent amount. I mean, all Tuesday night, it could be 1 to 3 inches, depending on where.
Yeah.
And 1 to 3 inches again overnight Tuesday night. So it looks like...
And the mountains will get... I mean, the ski hills will probably get more, though.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
they'll a lot get of natural
maybe 6
snow
inches
there.
Yeah, possibly
sure.
up there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So speaking about that, Fran, your position... I presume you're working from home these days.
I am currently working from home.
Right, and you work for the Ulster County Tourism.
Yes.
I'm not sure if you call it a department or a what. It's just Ulster County Tourism.
It is a department. Yes, the Department of Tourism.
Department of Tourism. So, once upon a time, the ski mountains attracted zillions from the metropolitan area. Hunter, Wyndham, and Bel Air. Any thoughts about this year? Probably less, but still some?
Things have obviously been a little different this year, and being in Ulster County, like, Bel Air is our main focus, but as you know, a lot of the ski resorts are on a advanced ticket basis or pre-registration,
right.
So they can kind of track the numbers. So tracking numbers and knowing how many to expect has been a little different this year. But since they're not at full capacity, just like our accommodations, they have been full and busy when they have snow.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that's good. Yeah, I forgot the other two are in
very much in the drive market right now. So, folks are still coming out of the city, coming from Connecticut, Long Island, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, close to our borders, so that, we're seeing a lot of drive traffic.
Yeah. Well, the restaurants, I was just talking to, telling Dan, Leanne and I were out to La Canard. How do you say the other part of it, Dan?
Le Canard Enchaîné.
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 And it was pretty crowded, I have to say, Saturday night, Saturday evening into night. Yeah, it was good to see. No, Fran, I was wondering if, you know, since the folks in New York City don't have in dining, right? If you're mm-hmm. going to eat, you got to eat in 17 degree weather.
or drive 90 miles.
Or drive 90 miles.
And that is absolutely the case. We have a lot of people up for the weekend from various parts of the south of us.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very true. Yeah, there are a lot of weekenders that come up for just a little lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know, a little lifestyle change.
We actually
from
went
the
to
rigors
dinner
of the city.
In another restaurant at a Front Street Tavern, Mark Guido's place. And then went for a beautiful dessert that Dan pointed out appropriately, and he nailed it. So that was great. Thank you so much.
What was that?
Yeah, and that restaurant was crowded. So I say crowded for, you know, COVID times. Probably not crowded for normal times. There was actually four people at the bar, which I was shocked at. You know, because I don't think you don't see that much. How about La Canarda? Dance and bar folks, people just having a drink?
No. Bars
are
really
off.
Really kind of, there's a couple people that'll
we'll
you know
eat
like,
there,
yeah,
eat,
and
eat
we have to have like pairs of chairs spaced, you know, people come in together so they're allowed to be together.
Yeah.
but pairs of chairs are spaced across, mostly
pairs
it's for waiting
chairs.
For the
That's a-
yeah pairs of chairs. mostly people are waiting, maybe for a specific table.
Okay.
Or there's a little bit of after work, you know, early evening bar that usually kind of dissipates by around 7:30. But Fran, you asked about the desserts. They had cheesecake, creme brulee.
Oh wow.
And flourless chocolate cake.
I think I had an almond
tart. Almond tart.
Yeah,
okay,
the almond
tart.
Yeah.
So I heard you asking. So
oh, I'm sorry, I missed.
I figured we'd bring it up.
Yeah, you can't just say dessert and not tell me exactly.
Yeah.
What
well, the creme de la creme is the creme brulee.
Yeah.
That's probably the most asked for dessert at Le Canard.
Yeah, we had Jess Davis on Thursday with retired Judge Don Williams on the Thunder Thursday show, and she was talking about the Ulster Eateries website, it's a Facebook page that I think the chamber started, but I'm not 100% sure of that. Do you know?
Yes, the chamber.
Which is really a great resource. I mean, I have to say that there were restaurants in there, or there are restaurants in there that I really didn't know existed here. So, you know.
Yeah, it's an incredible resource. And I think they have like over like 11,000 members.
Which is crazy. That's
great.
Yeah,
it's fantastic. You learn something new every day on it. And it's always nice when somebody asks where they can find in search of, and you know where they can find it.
Yeah.
And you learn things like, I don't know if it's exactly on Ulster Eateries United that I learned this, but remember 32 Lunch in Rosendale?
Yeah.
Did you know it's not 32 Lunch anymore?
No, is it 33 Lunch?
What? It's called the Truss and Trestle. Renovated. It's really cool. You guys will have to look it up.
Okay. What's the first word?
Truss, T-R-U-S-S.
Truss and Trestle. Wow. Okay. I wouldn't think that was a restaurant. I don't know. I thought it would be like a railroad museum or something.
Well, they're close to the bridge. So
cool.
So I'm thinking that's where they were going with it.
Same type of food or hard to say?
I'm sorry?
What kind of food did they have? Do you know?
The menu looked pretty cool.
Okay.
Eclectic. They had some brunch things. They had mimosas and Bloody Marys.
Okay.
Well, I know that's
sound
not
like food
in some people's
but
world, but the menu looks good.
What else is going on? So normally January can be a slower month for tourism, but is that true? Well, because of COVID, but what's your sense about this year?
Well, you know, it's not our, it's funny. It's not our August, September, October. But it's, we still have people coming and inquiring, constant requests for information, and people coming up every week, every weekend. But, you know, the numbers are kind of like running marginally from each season that we have, but we always have traffic. And people are, you know, we are a perfect drive market. So
places like the Emerson, Diamond Mills, Mohonk, they're all open, correct?
They are open, but, you know, they're not at full capacity. So they're booked, but it's not like they're booking the whole house because they can't be.
Yeah, sure.
So, but they are most booking out, especially on the weekends.
Yeah. Well, we're knocking on the door of February, so, you know, maybe as the vaccine keeps getting out there and seems like there's a really big push. I mean, we have to hope about something, right?
We do.
I mean, because that's what humans like to do. We're hopeful beings. We hope that, you know, next year is going to be better and next week's going to be better and tomorrow's going to be better and... So, I mean, you know, otherwise, you know, people will be on a one big collective, psychiatrist couch, you know, and feel like, okay, it's going to be group therapy now, folks, you know, but,
it's hard enough to get through February and March in this weather in normal years. So yeah, coming up on a year of this lockdown situation is, pretty tough getting through these dreary months, although you're a skier, so they're not dreary to you.
Right, exactly. Yeah, we want to give our best to Lorraine, and she's going through a little personal thing right now, and so everything hopefully will come out, not her personally, family personal. And so we got some great guests today for this marvelous Monday, the Marvy Monday show.
The Marvy Monday show.
I'm not sure that's going to stick, Dan.
What do we have, 7:30, Tony?
We have 7:30, John Quigley. John is with the Board of Elections, correct?
Yes, he's the new Republican side commissioner for Board of Elections
there
after Tom Turco's retirement.
Great. John's a great young, he's a great guy. He happens to be, I have like t-shirts older than John, but we won't talk about that. We will not talk about
too,
that.
Actually.
We will not. and then at 8 o'clock, we have Karianna Haasch. I hope I'm saying that right. She is the owner of the Artisan Bakery on Broadway. Excited about that. And I was actually had a little mild dream that she brought in like a little cupcake of some kind. But we'll see. If she doesn't, I'm on a diet anyway, so it's fine. I mean, I went on her website and her Facebook page, and boy, there's some delectable little ditties there. Pretty nice stuff on the Artisan Bakery.
Oh, wait a second. You said you're on a diet.
Well.
What were you doing at Le Canard?
I know that. That's why I'm on a diet. No, I'm trying to run again, and, you know, believe it or not, 5 pounds, you know, running is 5 pounds less is better on everything, the knees. And so, and then our third guest is Raleigh Green, right? Raleigh is...
the one and only Raleigh Green.
The one and only. They broke the mold when they made Raleigh, and he's... he's a guy who's doing a lot of local... public relations and marketing and helping out many companies, you know, with their Facebook pages, and interested to hear Raleigh's take on the world. So yeah, it should be a fun show. And you know, we'll take call-ins too. Dan, want to take a call in here or there? We can, right, Fran?
Yes, and Raleigh asked if there would be a cow pie giveaway and bell ringing. And
well, unfortunately, we have no birthdays. I'm sure there is a birthday out there somewhere, but we don't have it in our little folder. So please Please get your cards and birthdays in. You can send them into P.O. Box 4364. Well, Kingston Community Radio, obviously, 4364, Kingston 12402. And our Gmail site, Dan, do you know that one?
Yeah, it's kcr921@gmail.com.
Okay, so we'll take little emails about
Emails,
Aunt Polly's birthday. And,
exactly.
So please send those in so we can have some fun with that. And we're thankful to Voices for donating those delicious cow pies. I haven't had one in a while, Fran. I'm kind of missing one. Yeah, I'm talking about food. I'm trying to lose 5 pounds. And
a cow pie is not going to help that.
That's not.
Pretty sure.
Yes, you're correct.
Yeah, so, somebody should have sent birthdays in. On Facebook, I have 3 people who have birthdays today.
Well, you can mention their name on the air if you want. That's up to you.
Well,
you want to mention
somebody
them?
Should have sent it in for them.
Yes.
Fred Costello up in Socrates is having
kidding.
A birthday today.
He's a
very interesting cast right here. Maria Totoro from Phoenicia
Festival. Oh, my word. You've got to be kidding me.
Apparently, today is her birthday.
Okay. Well, thank you.
And Effie Tartoris.
Oh, jeez.
Happy birthday. Yeah.
Wow. Okay, so none of you get a cow pie, but
none of you get a cow pie. Oh,
but hope you have a great birthday. Fred is a co-host on Super Wednesday with Greg Chorvis and a gaggle of law enforcement folks.
Very nice.
And our assembly person Kevin Cahill comes in and. So, yeah. In fact, all our shows now are up on YouTube. Did you know that? Every show that we do pretty much gets recorded.
They archived on YouTube?
They're archived, the YouTube channel, yep. So Lawrence and I collaborate on that, and about once a week we post shows. So if you've missed a show or want to go back and, you know, check out a prediction that somebody made, you can do that on YouTube. I think you can also go on mykcr.org and click on the link. That'll take you to our YouTube channel. I know people do that to listen live, and it's getting more popular. Folks, depending on where they are, maybe don't have a great radio signal, and so they can click on that YouTube link. So kind of cool. You know, getting up there in the modern world.
I can watch it live. I'm watching you now.
Yeah, watch live.
That is not Coral, the sweater.
Oh, you're watching now. I said, we okay, thank you. What is it? Do you know what the color is? Okay, we have a caller. You can think about it for a second. Okay. Good morning, caller. You're on Marvelous Monday. What's your question or comment?
Good morning, Tony.
Hey, Mike, how are you, man?
Good, how are you?
Good. Long time no talk. And Fran is on the line.
Good morning.
Hello.
Fran. How are you?
Good, thanks.
How's it going, Mike? Hanging in?
Yeah, pretty much. You know, we've been quarantining and...
Right.
Watched the football games yesterday and...
Yeah, they were pretty good, generally.
Yeah, in general. The second one between Kansas City and Buffalo got a little ugly at the end.
Oh, did it? Yeah. I didn't watch at the end. I mean, I figured Kansas City was going to win, so I think, I don't know, I watched something else.
I kind of thought that too, but I was only going to say so if Mahomes played, and, Mahomes did play.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he had that concussion the week before.
Right.
And, it should be an interesting Super Bowl. And you got Tampa playing on its home field.
Yeah.
And I kind of think that the Super Bowl should be played on the home field of the team with the better record.
Yeah, that's interesting. Kind of like the World Series.
I mean, as opposed to a neutral site all the time.
Yeah. That's a good point. And Tom Brady is how old is he? Like 51 or something like that?
He's in his 40s, but you know.
Yeah. Well,
I think I'd like Kansas City to win it because
yeah,
Brady's had all this all the Super Bowl stuff. Although some of the, although most of those players on Tampa have never,
right?
They don't even know what a Super Bowl is.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. I mean, so are they going to allow fans in the stands down there? I think Florida is a little bit looser, right, than some of the other states.
Well, I'm not. You know, I have my doubts about it. But I wanted to make a point to you.
Yeah.
Several weeks ago, you made a prediction as to what was going to be happening so far as the COVID was concerned.
You mean somebody listens to my predictions?
I mean, like, this is the dark time now. And, you know, if the vaccine finally becomes available and becomes, you know, where people can just get to the...
Widespread, the damn right? Widespread
and move
availability.
On.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think it'll be slow, but I think, like you said, in 2022 will probably be like the Roaring Twenties, where everybody's going to be everywhere. And,
oh yeah. Hey, I'm hopeful. I might be a little optimistic, but that's just me. That we're going to have our Italian festival in October. I don't know. I'm hopeful we'll have enough shots in the arm to get that out there. And I get it. You know, some people won't come out. But if the mass gathering laws are upgraded, because by then 150 million people would have been vaccinated. I mean, they're talking about 100 million vaccines in the next, you know, in the 100 days here, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So.
And, you know, one thing is that over and above the Italian festival, all the other festivals and the other events that we're used to going to and or participating in during the course of a year, I personally miss it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, you know, I was really at the, as you know, last year at this time I was laying in a bed in a hospital.
Right, right, right.
And my thoughts were, well, once I get out of here, you know, I'll go to the Y, swim some laps, and
you can still do that, by the way. The Y is open.
Yeah,
and the pool is open.
I heard about that.
Yep.
And I'm going to start considering it a little more strongly, but you know, it's just being around people, and you know,
You can be smart about that too. You know, you can mask up and
just as safe as can be.
Yep. No, I get it. No, you've been through a lot. So, but yeah, a year ago it was, you know, who knew what this was, right? So
it was being talked about.
Yeah, so I don't know. Fran, you have a prediction? Did I ask you? I think I asked you and Lorraine for a prediction, didn't I, when I was on your show a couple Mondays ago?
Yes, Lorraine and I did do our predictions for the year.
I believe we have that on tape, and it's on YouTube, so we're going to...
go back and look at those.
We're going to go back and look at that.
Was the prediction?
What was their prediction?
Your prediction that you were...
No, my prediction was by the end of the second quarter, which is June, you're going to see some more stirring, you know, and some positive things coming out.
Yes.
Yeah, because the warm weather will be here. And, you know, if you remember last summer, you know, it seemed like things were... Restaurants could serve outside. You know, people a little bit feeling better about what's going on. And, again... You know, I know there's issues with the vaccine, and but I think generally, last number I saw was about 30 million, but I could be wrong about 30 million.
Somehow, I just wonder what the excuse really is for the shortage. But
we don't want to go there because this is Marvelous
again,
Monday.
Again, you know, you're trying to roll with the punches and.
Well, humans are resilient, you know, and 5 years from now we'll say, hey, remember that pandemic?
Yeah.
I don't remember it.
Well, 5 years from now, I certainly hope that this pandemic will be somewhere up in outer space or something like that.
Right.
And
this one's COVID-19.
I mean, hopefully right? we don't send anybody to the area where that is, but you know.
Anybody know why they just started with 19? Or, you know, I know they just picked a number. Why didn't they start with 1? Novel coronavirus 1.
I think it was the year.
Oh, yeah. It was?
Yeah.
Oh, 19. Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, very good, Dan Gatiss.
Yeah.
I just...
well, there's supposed to be a worse version of this virus in South Africa or something like that.
All right. All right, so you're saying, like, if the next one shows up, it can be coronavirus, you know,
21
in the year 2525, if man is still alive?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If woman can survive.
2525, yeah.
All right, we're probably getting close to a break time here. Mike, thank you.
Okay, Tony.
Thanks
Take
for calling.
Care.
Be well.
Good talking to you.
Same here. All the best
Have
to Adele
show.
And your family.
Are you on every on no, some Mondays? Or?
No. I'm a filler-inner today. Lorraine Salmon couldn't make it, and Fran DePetrillo Savoca is calling from home. She's the co-host with Lorraine, but I'm Lorraine right. today.
Oh, okay. Okay. Oh, so they put the two ladies on Monday
right.
when the doctor's not on.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, listen,
thanks, Mike.
Again, have a good show, and
thank you so much.
I'll be
all
listening.
The best. Thank you so much.
Have a great day.
All right, Fran. Anything else there? And what did you make like eggs and bacon this morning? Or
yeah, you know that mornings are rough for me, whether I'm calling in from home or showing up to the studio. So no,
it'd
be a whole lot
that
of
would be maybe a cup
this
of coffee,
morning.
But,
I did feed the dog.
Okay. The dog is
Some
good.
Some things are important, you know.
Right. All right, Dan, let's go to break, and we'll come back with John Quigley.
Okay, and thank you, Tony Marmo and Fran DePetrillo Savoca. Thank you so much, and our call-in guests as well. You're listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio on AM 920 and 92.5 FM. My name is Dan Gatiss, and it is 7:30 a.m., Monday, January 25th, 14 degrees outside. And what else here? We're starting with 14 degrees. Mostly sunny today. High goes up to 34. Tonight, mostly cloudy, a low down to 21. And Tuesday, 90% chance of snow, high of 29, 1 to 3 inches of snow expected. And Tuesday night, 70% chance of light snow in the evening with snow showers continuing overnight. 1 to 3 inches again on Tuesday night. And a low of 28. Wednesday, mainly cloudy with snow showers around in the morning, 50% chance, and then a high of 37, and later on in the day, it'll be cloudy. And Wednesday night, mainly cloudy with low around 25, and we'll be right back.
Listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM and also online at mykcr.org.
The Home Energy Assistance Program can help make winter a little warmer this season with financial grants to eligible households to help pay heating or utility bills. Are you in need of assistance or know someone who is? Find out more about the benefits and eligibility requirements of the HEAP program by contacting your County Department of Social Services or by visiting the Assistance Program section of Central Hudson's website, centralhudson.com.
Is that a faucet running?
That's not a faucet. That's a river rushing through the forest. Forest rivers provide over 100 million people with clean water to drink.
What? I can't hear you because of the vacuum.
That's not a vacuum. That's the trees in the forest cleaning up the air we breathe.
I didn't know the trees were so amazing.
Yep, and the forest gives us shade, trees to climb.
That's awesome. Let's go explore some more.
Visit the forest today and enjoy all it does just for you. To learn more about the forest and find one near you, go to discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Cameron Rylance from Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio because it's informative.
And And we're back, and you have been listening to KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. We'll be here 7 to 9 AM, and it is 14 degrees on this Monday, January 25th. Kingston Community Radio is talk radio, and we welcome call-ins, 331-9255. This portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Central Hudson. And let's get back to the on-air studio with Tony Marmo and Fran and our new guest. Welcome back.
Great. Thanks so much, Dan. Well, welcome, Fran. How are you? You're in TV land, or?
Is it morning for you yet, Fran?
I don't know. Did we lose her, Dan?
Oh, no. Here I am.
Okay. Well, you're getting a hubby a cup of coffee or something, right?
No. I was trying to eat something, and the dog was begging, and so I was...
So you're feeding the dog.
Feeding the dog, and I put my hand down to put the phone down to feed the dog.
You know, I had a...
this is John Quigley,
John Quigley from Board of Elections. The other day, and I had my two German Shepherds running around in the background of the Zoom conference call.
Oh, great.
I'm sitting there, I'm like, oh, my God.
Yeah.
Adjusting to this remote lifestyle.
Yeah, yeah. Well, pets and Zoom, I guess that's okay, right? You can do pets and Zoom. Right? Do you ever bring your dog on a Zoom call, Fran?
Absolutely. Well, I don't bring her on. I have no choice because she just invites herself in.
Yep, it's that it's common pattern.
What's going on and what I'm looking at, and yeah, she spends more time on the screen than I do.
Now, this is a new dog because you had a dog that was a little bit up in years, correct?
Yeah, I had a 17 and a half year old poodle.
Right.
Toby, and he passed during COVID, unfortunately, in April. Okay. And we fostered a dog from the Ulster County SPCA in October.
Oh, nice.
And by November, we were failures, and she's here to stay.
Now, what kind of dog is she?
You know, we haven't sent her DNA in yet.
Can you do that for dogs?
Ancestry.
Do that.
Excellent.
Yes, she's going to be like a super mutt, I'm sure. But everybody has an opinion of what. Yeah, it's too bad you guys can't see me on YouTube because she's sitting right here.
Right.
So, yeah, we just got her registration papers because you have to have those to send the DNA in. And so, yeah, that's our next step. So she's super mutt. Maybe next month
super
we'll know
mutt.
What she
okay.
is.
Who'd have thunk it? Like part German Shepherd, part Italian Mastiff, and part Chihuahua.
Yeah, exactly. She came from Louisiana during COVID. So they really have no idea much of other than she did have some abuse, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But she has a lot of potential. So
well, that's kind. Yeah. It's kind of you two to foster a dog like that. So welcome, John Quigley.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Was a late call. Fran put the pressure on you, right, Fran?
Yeah, right. No.
There wasn't too much arm twisting.
And congratulations, John Quigley, on being the commissioner of Board of Elections.
Thank you. I'm surprised I got a congratulations and not a condolence. But coming out of this past election cycle, I appreciate everything that our election workers go through now a lot more.
Yeah.
It's a difficult time, but there's still lots to be done, and I'm fortunate enough to be commissioner now and sort of have an opportunity to voice and steer the ship in one direction. And I get to work with a great co-commissioner in Ashley Dittus, and we're able to do our best to provide quality elections here in Ulster.
Ashley is also a younger person like you, correct?
The two of us.
Oh, huh? We've got a strong young team there.
The two of us are the youngest election commissioners in New York State.
Wow. How impressive is that?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
I think I beat her out for being like one of the youngest in the commissioner position more recently. I don't know how far back we could go with history, but the two of us together, yeah. The average age of a commissioner, if you look at some of these other boards, is late 60s, early 70s.
Well, that's what I was going to say. You can add your two ages together and probably come up with the age of most commissioners.
Yeah, out of all honesty.
Well, we love Tom Turco. But
And who's happily enjoying retirement right now.
How long has Ashley been in her position?
I want to say 4 to 6 years.
Okay.
Yeah, if not a little bit longer. Vic Work.
Oh, Vic Work. Right. Yeah, that was...
She sort of like went through all the different roles. She started out as a clerk and made her way through.
Interesting.
Had a chance to see every aspect of the job. I started at deputy. Was really thrown in a year where change was happening. Mm-hmm. So it's actually really nice to see our dynamics where she's seen things from the start and I'm a fresh perspective who's usually sitting there saying, well, why are we doing it this way?
Right.
Is there another way to do it?
Right.
And all of a sudden we come up with some sort of agreement where we say, yeah, there's actually an easier way. So
you're a local fella, right? Give you a little background. Give a background.
Born and raised in Kingston. I went to Kingston Catholic and then I went to Coleman and I wish Coleman was still open, but I know we'll find a niche community like that around here eventually. I'm fifth generation to be born and raised in Kingston.
Wow.
My family goes way back from having ice houses where we used to store ice down on the waterfront to doing real estate to a grocery store over on Greenkill and Washington Avenue, that area by Stewart's. A lot of family history here.
That's good. And plus, we like the fact, speaking about DNA and 23andMe and all that stuff, Angie, he's got some Italian blood in him.
Yes.
Right?
Yes,
from mom, Joan.
Yes, my mom's side has a bit of the Italian. My dad's the true Irishman. Lots of Irish on that side of the family. But it's nice to see the heritage. I actually did do the 23andMe.
Nice.
My dad's been holding out on doing his, but...
Uh-oh.
But
might be a little secret in there somewhere we're not going to divulge.
Well, that's okay. He's already in yours.
Yes,
so when you do yours, you get all of your dad's.
I'm able to get a bulk of his from mine. So it's really nice to see. It's more of trying to link back even further because he's done all the family history back to us coming from Ireland. But we got stuck at that point where we tried to find, all right, where in Ireland did our family actually come from? So
the good old-fashioned way when you used to have to, you know, write places for records or go and visit there and... The churches were, a big place for that, right?
Yeah.
Just go and find the church records and, you know. So what was your mom's Italian name?
Oh, boy, that beats me.
A stumper.
Yeah.
How about them Tampa Bay Buccaneers?
Yeah, now you got me on the spot. I'm trying to remember.
Side, John, is on her mom's side, right?
Say it again, Fran.
The Italian on Joan's side is
on
her mom's side, right?
My grandmother's side.
Yeah.
And
all right.
She's a Buddenhagen, so
grandmother's
maiden
name.
She actually had a bulk of Polish as well as Italian.
Oh, okay.
So
interesting. Geez, I worked a long time ago at Kingston Hospital with a Dorothy Buddenhagen. I mean, that was, you know, I started at Kingston Hospital in 1980, so... I've seen just about every name in Kingston roll through there, you know, Italian and non-Italian. Interesting. So, John, I guess, you know, with this last election cycle and you know, quote unquote, you know, the air quotes of fraudulent elections and this election got stolen. And I'm not talking about any conspiracy theories. I'm not talking about just, you know, the mechanics of this thing. I'm trying to think about how do you steal an election? I mean, John. How do you steal one?
Well, if you want to know, you can give me a phone call later and we can talk about it.
great. Yeah, no, but, I don't want to know.
Out of all honesty, though, to speak to that perspective, here in New York State, we have one of the most robust, well-tested systems where our Board of Elections is governed by two differentiating parties. And you can throw a third variable in there at some point or however you'd like to do it. But the point of the fact is that two people have to essentially agree at multiple steps along the way for something to go wrong.
Right.
So there's always that check and that balance. Everything I do, Ashley has to sign off on. And it goes for even when you check in to vote. There's two people representing two different parties who they're at the end of the day, they're not there about party affiliation.
Right.
They're there about checking the person sitting next to them and making sure that the check-in goes correctly. and that they're able to go through the voting process. And even when you submit your ballot into the machine, there's two individuals that stand at the machine to make sure the machine is reading it correctly. So every step, it would take a lot of effort and a lot of people to basically work together to make that happen. A lot of our systems are done independently of each other so that there is no internet interference, people thinking that somehow people can get into our system. It's pretty much a lockbox.
Your results roll up to, I guess, another point? What happens to your results?
So when our results come in from the county, we have to feed those results up to the state, and then the state will feed them up to the national level. And what you'll actually see is a lot of the states that were in question in this past presidential election were states where their board of elections are ran by state departments. Yep. They're people who are appointed by the governor of that state. They're people who have political motive or political affiliation strongly rooted in how they administer that election.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
Here in New York, unfortunately, I do think it may come under question in the next couple years as to, well, why do we have this bipartisan system? And you might see people in the state legislature test that and maybe try and change it. But I have to be honest, I hope that it wins out and we keep our system as is. We have something to build on and to actually share with other states on how to run their board of elections. It's hopeful. I got to be honest, the gentleman who called in earlier, I know there's a lot of negativity in the world right now, but I think there's also a lot to be hopeful for, because during the greatest challenges come some of our greatest successes.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Fran, any questions for John?
Not so far.
No, I find it's intriguing, because why would you change a system that seems to be functional and working and represents both parties? Unless maybe somebody cooks up a third party down the road, or fourth party or whatever. But to me, it seems eminently fair that there are checks and balances, and I guess anything is possible with respect to internet fraud, right? I mean, people hack away and, find my checking account that has about 38 cents in it, and they can have it, But that's...
There are things that can be done to make the election more secure. I hate to say this, because this is always taken a little bit too straight to the point, but some sort of verification. I don't want to call it voter ID, but if you're willing to have two-factor authentication on your bank account so somebody can't get into your bank account, you should want to have some sort of two-factor authentication on your vote so that nobody can steal your vote. And that's not to say that people are. It's just to say that we should be treating our votes as sacred.
As financial.
Yeah.
Records.
Yeah.
I think that's 100% correct. We voted this year in the Midtown Center. We live in Ulster Park and normally vote at the firehouse. But I think it was either, because of the COVID, did you limit the numbers or early voting, or what was the...
So we have early voting now, which luckily spaces out when you can go to vote, and we may see rules change as to when and how we conduct that this year to give it more options. So we were able to do 9 days of early voting this past election, and we had 5 sites across the county. We're only required to have 1, so we do a great job at exceeding the expectations and giving our voters accessibility. We quickly saw after the first day that there was going to be this continued demand for early voting. We had to expand some of our sites. We had to adjust on the fly. We had to be ready to increase capacity at each site, and some sites were limited in the capacity they could reach. Midtown was probably one of the ones that we felt we had the most unlimited capacity.
Oh, that was easy, man. That was
the largest site.
And plenty of, you could have taken a bath in the sanitation.
The hand sanitizer.
There was like gallons of it there, and gloves, on top of gloves. So they did a good job with that.
We tried to put a process in place where the voters could come in and feel as comfortable as possible using every step that was available to us.
Yeah.
I was I was glad to see that we actually had to adjust on the fly to the early voting, because I was concerned not enough people were going to come out to vote this year, or they were all going to come out at the same time, and it was going to cause a lot of people concern for being at the poll sites.
So early voting, here to stay.
Here to stay. We'll see some sort of expansion.
It does. We'll be voting in July. No.
It does create some sort of logistical nightmares for some of us at the Board of Elections, but we adjust to them on the go, and we make.
And those results are not known, right? I mean,
They essentially
can't let those out, right?
They essentially stay at that site until the end of the 9 days before they get back to
us. So it's 9 days prior to Election Day.
Technically 10, because there's that 10. That Monday before Election Day, there's no voting.
Right, okay.
It gives us a chance to turn things around from those 9 days and make sure that everything on Tuesday, we have to account for the fact that if you did vote early, that like you can't go vote on Election Day. So there's a lot of like buffering and time that needs to take place to put our iPads in place to say, okay, this person went and voted early, they can't come on Election Day.
Yeah, right. That's important, or else somebody could vote half a dozen times. I was a little taken aback, but maybe it was the circumstances. And I was with Leanne, who, you know, I know a lot of people in Kingston, but she is a local. Mm-hmm. You know, she's born in Lake Katrine, so she knows a zillion people too. But we knew the person, I think, from bowling. Actually, I think she bowls with her that registered us. But I don't remember. Do you have to show an ID?
You don't have to.
You don't have to.
What happens is
I'm Dan Gatiss, and
that's always puzzled my husband about voting. Like, why don't we? He always goes and gets his license and makes sure he has it with him, and I'm always like, you don't need that. And he's like, well, why don't I need that? Tell us, John.
So registering to vote, we treat your signature on a piece of paper as your security method currently. Okay. And that signature is unique to you, as long as you fill out the voter registration form properly and say that you do live here in Ulster County and you want to vote here. That's the limitation of what we're able to do. We really can't even investigate whether or not you do actually live here. We have to go by your word on that piece of paper. A lot of it is being automated. Potentially, the New York State Legislature is going to pass a automatic voter registration law. That would just, every time you go to the DMV, essentially update your information as to where you're living and making you registered. You would essentially have to opt out of wanting to register to vote.
Okay. If you don't have a license, though, that kind of obviates that, right? I mean, correct. So you just, I don't know. It seems a little weak on that side, a little weak.
Maybe. You'd never be able to forge my signature.
Yeah, I know. Yours is one of those squiggly things, and it reminds me of one of my wayward kids that would, please excuse Lucas Marmo from school today. Sign Anthony. I'm like, really?
Signatures are very tough to duplicate when you see everybody's signature.
Really? You think so?
A lot of them are unique and.
I can go with that. Handwriting analysis stuff. I mean, I don't know.
You would think I should probably get a degree in that, considering the amount of signatures I look at every year. But it's the current method. It's effective.
Okay.
It maybe I should say more efficient than effective. There are definitely improvements that can be made. Well, because, like I said, two factors, making two sort of steps to verify your vote versus just one. It makes it that much harder for somebody to steal your vote, and a lot harder for us to argue that there's any voter fraud going on.
Yeah. I was on a Rotary Zoom call with a fellow, and I'll tell you off the air what his name is, but he's been in Commissioner of Elections in a neighboring county. He was incensed that there would be these allegations of fraud. He was like really honked. I mean, he was like, you don't understand, blah, 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 blah. And it was like litany of reasons why, so I don't know what party he is, quite honest. I didn't even ask, but he was really upset.
I had the experience with a couple candidates who had just lost their last election cycle, and they're looking at the results and they're looking at the numbers and they're like, I don't understand. I talked to so many people, I thought I got this many votes, and there's got to be something wrong with the system. I'm just like, let's not start going down that rabbit
hole. Yeah, it's a rabbit hole, right.
a lot of people, especially during the candidate's perspective going door to door, a lot of people just are telling candidates what they want to hear to get them off their doorstep nowadays, because politics is something not many people want to talk about anymore. It's too polarizing for us.
Correct. The other one is mail-ins. You know, it seems like there's more, we'll call them, I guess, absentee, or is that different than mail-in?
Yep. So absentee versus mail-in, they're two different things. Fortunately, here in New York State, we have what's known as absentee voting. So there's a application that's required. So it's a more recent check of your signature, as well as applying for the absentee. So you have the ability to check the signature on the back of the absentee ballot once it gets mailed back to us versus that application that you sent in. So there's an extra step of verification. That's not too bad, because we can compare the signature on the application as well to the signature on record from previous years, to see if there's any change or anything. But we don't just mail out ballots, and I hope this is another measure. The state legislature seems to be very interested in elections this year. For good or for bad, not everything's good, but they're looking at how the absentee application works, and I'm a bit concerned that we have to somehow protect that application as the way to verify people who want to vote by mail. Because it becomes very concerning to me when we have two ballots that are essentially associated with one individual floating around out there. And there's a thought that we might just start mailing ballots to everybody's household and then give them the option should they want to go vote.
Interesting. Well, this is great. I mean, this is fascinating. We have to have you back on one of the shows on KCR to kind of keep folks in the loop. I also want to mention that recently you were nominated to join the YMCA board.
I
wonder who nominated you, huh?
Well, yeah, he was kind of, well, voluntold, but no. thank you.
When I heard from you about joining the YMCA, I thought, oh, this is a very good, deep-rooted organization that helps our community, and I'd love to find a way to contribute to them. And then I jumped on a Zoom call with Heidi, and as soon as she told me some of the plans for the YMCA, I was like, there's no need to convince me.
Thank you for doing that.
I'm excited to see what lies ahead for the YMCA. A lot of potential to
absolutely
do good for our community and grow.
It's a different organization than it was, you know, in the Bob Stubbs era, long time ago in a land far, far away. You know, but thank you. It's great to have some younger folks as well involved in our community organizations. And I notice that you're drinking super coffee. Speaking about younger folks.
Shout out to Super Coffee. I happen to be a subscriber.
Oh, you are? Yeah. I'm digging it too, man. I might have to just subscribe, you know. You're familiar with those young fellas, Fran, right?
The DePetrillo brothers.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I grew up playing soccer. Oh, my God. I always forget which one because there's
Jake is
in the middle of all three of them.
Yeah.
So played soccer a couple years with them, and it was awesome to see their successes to go on and grow into something that's positive.
Yeah.
You say it right on here, positive energy.
Yep. Kingston, New York. It's good stuff.
They live and breathe what they preach.
And your dad's doing good, Supervisor Town of Ulster?
Yes. He's over his COVID experience. But he's chugging along.
Is he feeling okay now?
Yeah, fortunately for him, it wasn't as severe as others have experienced. It was more of a little less than a flu-like symptoms.
Right.
The irony in the whole publication in the Daily Freeman was the reporter called asking about Buffalo Wild Wings, listening on the phone call and saying, excuse me, Mr. Quigley, you don't sound so well. That's because I got caught COVID. And all of a sudden the story goes from Buffalo Wild Wings being closed to supervisor at Town of Ulster has COVID.
Right.
I was like, wow, that's a great story. How do you change that around? Some reporting. But yeah.
That figures. My question is Buffalo Wild Wings open or not open?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, whatever happens to that Buffalo Wild Wings story.
Right. Give them our best.
I mean, it's tough now when you see businesses close, your automatic assumption is, they must be just recovering from COVID.
Yeah, it's unbelievable, the number of businesses. That's why I marvel at the restaurants hanging in, the quality restaurants, good food, good service. I mean, but a lot of them have dropped by the wayside. It's so sad. Really is. Hopefully we're going to keep chugging along and, get power through this with some super coffee. Get a little super coffee.
But, we definitely still have some tough roads ahead.
Yeah. By the way, you hear very little about seasonal flu these days. I mean, I don't know. I haven't heard any cases of seasonal flus.
Absolutely not. No. It's the protection that's required for COVID right. just overpowers the contraction of
But I think
flu.
A lot of folks got the I didn't get it, but I think a lot of folks
got the flu shot.
Got the flu shot this year.
Yeah. In preparation and concern of
Yeah, so who knows but we'll keep figuring it out. Just keep plugging along. Thank you, John Quigley, for all you do. For I feel better about the Board of Elections already instantly.
Thank you.
But it's Fran.
Thanks, John, for having me. Doing the job you do.
Yeah, no, it's cool. Very cool, and. Keep chugging. We were talking off the air. John's a big bowler as well, involved in the only bowling alley left in the Kingston area, top of the hill there.
Good Monday night hobby of mine. So
yeah,
I'll
it's a great. Well, good tonight. Good luck tonight. Maybe we'll bring you some luck. We were talking about it. It is science and there's technique, but there's also a little bit of luck.
Yeah,
here and there, right? You can't.
Luck more than some, but yeah.
So, I was saying, Fran, if I bowl, I'm, happy if I break 100, and his average is like 204.
Okay.
So that's, it's...
I'm bowling with you. Leanne and John can bowl together.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. And we'll be there, trying to keep our ball out of the gutter. Have you had 300 games?
I haven't. I had an elusive 300 has escaped me.
Leanne's had, I think 268 or 270. There's maybe one ball or two balls away.
298 was the high.
298,
yeah,
holy
so
cannoli.
That last ball, and it was just the jitters of throwing it.
Yeah, wow, okay. John Quigley, thank you so much. Fran, thank you. Come back, feed the dog, and get a bite to eat yourself. We're waiting for our next guest. Dan, take it away.
And thank you, John Quigley, for coming in and filling us in on a lot about the Board of Elections. Thank you. Monday, January 25th, 14 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. You've been listening to Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ AM 920 and 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Central Hudson. Weather and forecast for Kingston and the surrounding areas. Today, mostly sunny, a high of 34. Tonight, mostly cloudy, low 21. Tuesday, 90% chance of snow, and it's a high of 29, 1 to 3 inches expected for Tuesday. Tuesday night, the snow continues, 70% chance of light snow in the evening with snow showers continuing overnight, 1 to 3 inches, and a low of 28. Wednesday, mainly cloudy with snow showers around in the morning, 50% chance, and a high of 37. Wednesday night, mainly cloudy, a low around 25, and we'll be right back.
Listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM and also online at mykcr.org.
The Home Energy Assistance Program can help make winter a little warmer this season with financial grants to eligible households to help pay heating or utility bills. Are you in need of assistance or know someone who is? Find out more about the benefits and eligibility requirements of the HEAP program by contacting your County Department of Social Services or by visiting the Assistance Program section of Central Hudson's website, centralhudson.com. Don't. Just don't. If you see a low-hanging or downed wire, don't touch it. Don't move it. Don't go near it. Don't drive over it. It may be a power line carrying an electric current strong enough to kill. But here's what to do. Stay at least 30 feet away and call 911. Central Hudson will take care of the problem.
If you come close to a wire, shuffle away with small steps and watch your step. Wires may be hidden in fallen tree limbs or near water. Your safety matters.
Hi, this is Scott Harrington from Hurley, and I support Kingston Community Radio because the people need a place to have their voice heard, and it's lost in corporate radio, so please keep listening and supporting our station.
And we're back. You're listening to WGHQ AM 920 and 92.5 FM, the home of Kingston Community Radio. It's 8.02 a.m., 8.03 a.m., Monday, January 25th, and 14 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. This upcoming segment of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Herzog's. Stop by Herzog's Home and Paint Center in the Kingston Plaza for all of your home building and maintenance and painting needs. Discover the difference of buying local. And at Herzog's.com, there are ongoing sales. Now let's get back to the on-air studio with Tony Marmo and Fran DePetrillo Savoca. Welcome back.
Folks, we're back. This is, well, we called it Marvelous Monday just for today, Fran. Are you there? She might be feeding the dog again. She was in between. So this is Tony Marmo, and we're joined by Karianna Haasch. Did I say that right?
Yes, you did.
Okay,
that's
great.
Correct.
Perfect. So, but before we get to Karianna, Fran's on? Great. Are you there, dear?
I'm here.
Okay.
Hi, thanks for coming in.
Were you using the vacuum cleaner or something? What were you doing?
No, I lost the call. I don't know how, oh, okay. But I'm back.
No worries. So Karianna's with us, but we do have a birthday. Dan did give us a birthday. So, you know, Raleigh, I don't know if Raleigh's listening right now, but we can announce a very happy birthday on Monday, January 25th to Missy Volette. We're not sure, you know, how old Missy is, but
she's a youngster.
She's a youngster.
Yes,
okay.
She is,
that's good.
I didn't catch the name.
Okay.
I mean the age.
That's fine. And so Missy is the only contestant today in the happy birthday random selection. So Missy wins a delicious cow pie from Boyce Dairy Milk House, and she can pick that up at, I believe it's
62 O'Neill Street.
I was going to guess that.
Yeah, Boyce
Dairy
Milk House.
So she is the winner for today. All right. And we have this old cowbell here, too. That thing is like, that's how a cow moves, though, right?
Yeah. That's the one.
That thing is just moves really slowly. All right. Well, Fran, you're there.
I am here.
You are here. And we are with Karianna. So, Karianna, tell us, just give us a little background in terms of, you know, where you're from and what you did and how you got to this point of opening up a cool little bakery in
sure.
Kingston.
Yeah, so I'm the owner of Local Artisan Bakery right here in Kingston. Speaking of cows, I'm originally from Wisconsin.
Why did I know that?
Probably because we use a lot of butter and milk on our menu.
Okay, that's good. That's good.
What
part of Wisconsin?
I still have family in Madison. I lived a couple places, but mostly the southern part of the state. So
interesting. I had a feeling you were from Wisconsin. You know why? Because the word, the name Carrie is kind of a Midwestern-ish name, and mm-hmm. putting Carrie and Anna together is a Midwestern type of deal.
I can see that, yep. Yeah,
so there you go.
Yep.
Wife number one was from Racine, Wisconsin.
Oh, okay.
So, and in her family are some Carries. In fact, her brother, the oldest, she's one of 10. The oldest boy was Carrie, spelled differently than yours. And then there's another Carrie down the line somewhere, female Carrie. So that's, if I would have guessed, I would have guessed Wisconsin.
Well, you would have guessed correct.
Guessed correct. All right. So from Madison, Wisconsin.
Originally, yes.
To here somehow.
To here via school. I originally moved out here to go to school up in Troy.
Oh, nice.
And then just sort of worked my way down to Kingston, and I've lived in the Kingston area for the past 12 years now.
Wow. Okay. School for?
Ended up being industrial and management engineering.
What?
Completely, totally related to what I'm doing now as a business owner. But I actually did go back to school. I actually studied abroad for a year.
Okay.
And got my master's degree in international business management and did a dissertation in marketing. So that's kind of how I ended up into a marketing then career path, which then led to me becoming an entrepreneur.
Okay. And how did you get into the baking world?
I guess that's a good question that I don't entirely know the answer to. I've baked as long as I can remember, and it was sort of my therapy.
Okay.
You know, working in the corporate world, at the end of the day, I'd come home and I would bake stuff, and then
as a stress reliever.
Yeah, stress relief type thing, as a hobby, and then I would share it with friends and family and coworkers, and people kept telling me I should open up a bakery. And after some years of that, I finally just decided to.
All right. Well, that's interesting. And why Kingston? Why did you land here?
My first job out of college was actually in Kingston, and then I don't know. I just keep ending up
in the
here.
In the restaurant hospitality world, or you know what you're doing now,
is my absolute first job in food. I've never even been a waitress. Never worked in food or hospitality before. This is the first time doing it.
Wow.
So it was always...
Did you get like the, you know, 101 open up a business book or something? I mean, it's kind of it's kind of a leap, right? It's a little bit of a leap to go from what you were doing to just hanging a shingle saying, oh, we're going to just start baking stuff today and selling it.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was a gradual process. So I actually started as a pop-up bakery. I did like a home-based thing for a little bit. So I was selling at farmers markets and events.
Oh, okay.
So I did that for my first year. And then I was doing that on the weekend. I was still working my marketing consulting job during the week. And then made the leap to quit and do the pop-up full-time and then work on opening a brick and mortar. So our brick and mortar has been open for about a year and a half now. And the business itself, I've been in business for 3 years.
Great. Oh, wow. And what's the location of the business?
It's 448 Broadway. We're right at the intersection of Broadway and O'Neill Street, kind of diagonally across from the high school.
Fran, have you been in there?
I absolutely have. I love it there. And so my question is currently, are you open for walk-ins or... what's happening? I know there was a little stretch of time.
Yes. Not. Yeah. So we have our winter hours right now. So we're open Wednesdays through Saturdays currently.
Okay.
And so, we're doing walk-ins.
More than your baked goods for sale in there too.
Yes.
So what are your hours of operation?
So Wednesday through Friday is 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., and Saturdays is 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. right now.
That sounds good. Fran, Karianna gave me a sheet for Valentine's, and when I got started this morning, I said, you know, I'm trying to lose some weight because I want to start running. I have started running, and I'm thinking, well, if I lose 5 pounds, you know, I'll probably run a little bit easier, and so I'm looking at this, and I'm doomed. I'm absolutely doomed. Chocolate raspberry torte for
two.
Well, here, this is the Valentine's menu. So you can pick up something for Dan, you know.
Okay.
There's cheesecake for two. And then Valentine's cupcakes. Those look delicious. I shouldn't be looking at this. A heart Linzer. What's a heart Linzer tart? What's a Linzer?
A Linzer tart, they're like these tender like almond cookies that are filled with raspberry jam.
Lovely.
they're really nice. They're very special.
Okay, and then there's cake truffles. Who doesn't like a truffle?
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's like...
and they're filled with cake, so it's the best of both worlds.
There you go. Red velvet, pink vanilla, fudge brownie. Oh my gosh. Which is gluten-free, or you can get a variety pack. And then the last one on this list is fudge brownie hearts and also gluten-free.
Mm-hmm.
So my wife happens to have a nut allergy, so I have to... Why she's married to me, I have no idea. But, but yeah, so
This is cool. So
so you're not going to get her the Linzer tart?
No, no. I got to have to ask, you know, and everything has to be nut-free. But this, I love the descriptions here. Decadent chocolate cake with raspberry jam filling, chocolate glaze, and white chocolate shavings. Oh, my God. Naturally gluten-free. Kidding. I'm not a big dessert guy, am I? I didn't used to be.
Well, we always have quiche in our store, too. So
oh, great.
If you want to come in and grab something that's not sweet. There's always healthy
options. If you, I call them healthy options.
Yes. Right? What are they, Fran?
I said she always has healthy options, too. At least I call them healthy options.
Well, quiche is kind of healthy.
Quiche. We always have scones on the menu. Oh, good. And we use, even with our sweet scones, we use very, very little sugar. We really let the berries be the sweetness in the scones. So
interesting. So tell us, what do you like about Kingston? What's the, you know, what's the draw in Kingston? I mean, you can take it pre-COVID or during COVID, but, you know, what's the draw from in Kingston from you?
I really love the culture of Kingston. There's a lot of artists in Kingston. The proximity to all the local farms is really important for my business, for sure, because we use local ingredients in everything we bake. So that's really important. And then, you know, I've been able to collaborate with a lot of the local creative people. We actually have an entire gift section in our bakery as well. We work with over 20 local makers and have locally made gifts as well. So,
all right. Oh, that's great. So you're a collaborator.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, I've gotten to know other food businesses in the Kingston area, the owners of food businesses. And I feel like the kind of restaurant and food service community in Kingston has actually really strengthened throughout COVID. Like, we've all kind of banded together and tried to support each other. And like you said, I'm very collaborative. I'm all about that. And I think Kingston as a whole, I feel that sense of community from everyone, really. It's a good place, I think, to be a business owner overall.
You know Kristen Reimer? Does that name ring a bell?
Kristen Reimer? No.
She's a photographer in Kingston?
No, I don't. Yeah,
you should meet her. She's great.
Okay.
She's awesome. I'll send her your way.
Yeah.
She'll like your shop and you'll love her work. She's great. So you just joined the chamber recently as well, right?
I did, yes.
And tell us about that. What drew you to the chamber and what you like about the chamber?
Well, the chamber has been on my radar for quite a while, and honestly, the reason I didn't join initially was I didn't think I would have enough time to commit to attending the events and things and getting the most out of it. And then, you know, during the pandemic, I really saw how active the chamber is, not just like in person, like everything kind of moved online, and with the social media groups and everything, the Ulster Eateries group and all of that, I realized that it would be worthwhile for us to join, even if I couldn't commit to going to all the events. And props to the chamber. I feel like they've done such an amazing job supporting local businesses through this pandemic. And I know that my business has definitely gotten new customers by being part of it. And so I'm really glad we joined and really grateful for the work that they do. For
great.
Sure.
Well, Fran was employed there for how long, Fran, were you there?
10 years, and yes, I was at Karianna's ribbon cutting because I still sit on the board and the membership committee. So
yes.
Yeah,
I remember you being there.
That's some really. I feel like you had like specialty cornbread that day. Is that right?
I might have. We had a jalapeno cornbread on our menu
that
a couple
was
times.
Yep, it was delicious.
So, and our menu changes every week. So, you know, things, every time you come in, you're going to get something different. And we can always custom order something if there's something that you specifically want.
And you make those little hand pies, right?
Yes.
Like, I remember I'm a big strawberry rhubarb fan. And the one day I came in, you had strawberry rhubarb hand pies.
Yeah, we that make hand delicious. Pies. We also do full-size pies as like a custom order item. Around Thanksgiving, we made a lot of pies. but yeah, the hand pies are fun, and I love making those in the summer, too, because I feel like they're the perfect little thing to, like, take on a picnic, or if you want a pie, but you don't want to commit to a full pie, they're a nice little thing.
They're perfect, yes.
Karianna, how was the pandemic affected your business? Just curious. It seemed like you do a fair amount of takeout, but how is it? Has it affected it negatively for a little bit, or people got to eat and this
yeah.
is good stuff?
I mean, it's been a challenge. I think as a business owner, the challenge in part is not only keeping your business going and keeping the lights on, but protecting your staff, protecting your community. We're trying to do our part to keep from spreading,
right?
Obviously,
sure.
So last year we were closed. Our retail store was actually closed from March through August because I was sort of waiting to see how things were going to go.
Sure.
And we were just offering delivery and pickup at farmers markets at that time.
Nice.
And then we reopened in August, and we no longer have sit down. We used to have like cafe tables out. You could come in and sit down.
Have a coffee, have a whatever.
Exactly, yep. So we don't have the tables in anymore. It's just takeout only right now.
Right.
And, you know, we put in extra protective like barriers, those plastic barriers.
Sure.
And face masks are required and all of that, and we're doing extra sanitation efforts. So, you know, we've, like any other business, we've adjusted.
Adapted.
And
right.
We're trying. Definitely feel like foot traffic is probably slower because of the pandemic.
Sure.
But we've definitely been getting a very positive response in terms of our holiday orders, especially. I think a lot of people, because we offer delivery for holidays as well.
Nice.
So a lot of people, I think, have been ordering to then send something to their loved ones who live in this area if they can't be with them in person. So that's one way that we're kind of trying to make up a little bit of business by offering the local delivery at holidays.
Good.
And
that's
so
great.
We're trying to be creative.
I'm in the employment world. You know, I own Norman Staffing, and you know, we're finding kind of a shortage of people right now for a variety of reasons. You know, some folks intentionally on the sidelines because of COVID, they don't want to work, whatever. Another batch is just collecting unemployment insurance, and that seems to work well in their life. So they don't want to come back into the marketplace. How are you finding trying to attract staff at this point?
It's been a little challenging. Right now we're doing okay. And I have a baking apprentice who's been with me pretty much
from the get-go,
from the start almost.
Good.
And she's still with me. So counter staff has been a little come and go.
Sure.
And obviously it was hard while retail store was closed. I did have to furlough my staff during that time. So it's definitely a challenge. Come spring, we'll be looking to hire someone to do farmers markets for us.
Oh, good.
So that'll be good.
Yeah. Which ones do you go to around? Do you go to the King? There's two in Kingston now, right?
Fran, two in Kingston, yeah. We do the Uptown Kingston.
Right.
We also do Woodstock every week.
Okay.
And then we're looking to maybe join a third one this year. In the past, it's been me doing the market.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
This year we're actually looking to hire someone so that we can do a few more markets.
Good.
So
yeah, that's a lot of schlepping, right? It's a lot of carrying stuff and setting up and breaking down and setting up the tent. I mean, it's a lot of hard work, right?
Yeah, and it's a lot from a production standpoint too. I mean, the amount of goods that we sell one day at the market is as much as we sell in an entire weekend at the store. So it's basically like doubling your capacity for the weekend. So it's a lot of moving pieces, but they're really important, I think, and they're worthwhile for us for sure. So
the Artisan Bakery, the location again is
448
Broadway, right, in Kingston here. The phone number is, I have to put my dopey glasses on, is 481-3860. You can, let's see, the localartisanbakery.com is your website. Pretty simple.
We're on Instagram and Facebook as well, and that's where you see where what our menu is for each week. So if you follow us on Instagram or Facebook, I post the menu by Wednesday morning each week.
Okay. And Valentine's Day is kind of a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
As I'm sure was the Christmas holiday and Hanukkah and all that stuff, and people gear up. Despite the pandemic, you know, people still like their sweets, and they like good sweets. Would these look delicious? I can't look at them anymore.
Karianna, do you know what the third market is that you're considering adding this season?
I'm not sure yet. We're going to put in...
There's so many good ones to choose from.
Yeah, I mean, we'll probably try to add a Sunday market. So Woodstock is on Wednesdays, Kingston Uptown is Saturday, so I feel like Sunday would be the sensible one.
Yeah,
so
I know across the river. I know this is Ulster County. We're supposed to be promoting Ulster County, but Rhinebeck is kind of hop, skip, jump away.
Downtown has Sunday.
Downtown has Sunday.
Yes,
yeah,
they
I was
do.
Thinking yeah. about the downtown market because I know some people who did that last year, and I know some of the organizers. So we're thinking about that one. New Paltz is also Sundays. So, and we used to do New Paltz 2 years ago. We did New Paltz. So
Ulster County. Where is the downtown one? Where is that located?
It's at the T.R. Gallo Park, like right on the riverfront there.
Okay.
It's a nice location.
Paved area, kind of, sort of.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, I went to it a couple times last summer, because last summer was their first year. And
I've never been down there. Is it fairly well attended?
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much? About the same as the one uptown here?
It's a different format, so I think it's a little harder to tell, maybe, because...
Okay.
Up here, now that it's in the courthouse parking lot, it's very contained.
Right.
Whereas down there, people can kind of come in and out a little bit more freely, I think. So it's a little harder to tell, like, how many people. Because there's a lot of people just doing, you know, riverfront activities, too.
Yeah, right, exactly.
But, yeah, it seemed that when I was there, it seemed very busy, so.
Do we think they're going to get back, maybe, Fran, you know this, to closing off Wall Street again? Or is that maybe once the pandemic dies down a little bit?
Yeah, I don't think they have plans to put it back in Wall Street this
season. Is that because it's too dense or too, you know, too close to each other, or people kind of bump into each other? Or
that was part of it, right? And it's just they, like Karianna said, they can contain it better and track how many people are in the market and out of the market by holding it in the parking lot.
Gotcha.
And then that way, if any of the uptown restaurants are doing outdoor dining, sidewalk dining, then those two things don't interfere with each other.
And they are planning to do the courthouse parking lot again. I just resubmitted my application for
even
summer.
Even in the summertime?
Yes.
Oh, they're going to leave it
and
there.
And they had it on the application that they're doing it that format again this
right.
year, which worked well last
right,
year. We were there
to do
last
the outdoor
year.
Dining again, too. So, yeah.
Are there less vendors?
I think it's the same amount of vendors.
Oh, you do? Okay.
But, and that, again, that was part of the reason they moved it, so that they could have more, the same amount of vendors and have more space between everyone.
Space, yeah.
So we have, like, instead of tents being side to side, we had, like, a tent and then essentially an empty space and then another tent.
Gotcha.
To allow for people to line up and socially distance. And
gotcha.
It seemed to work well last year. So
it did work really well. Tony, did you go to the one in the courthouse parking lot?
I just drove by it. I don't think we've been in there yet. But,
it's a very nice setup. It was very well done.
Yeah, yeah. So, well, Karianna Haasch, thank you so much for coming in. It's great. The Artisan Bakery, 448 Broadway, is the place to go, and your hours are typically like 10-ish to 3-ish?
Yes, 10 to 4 in. During the week, Wednesday to Friday, 10 to 4. And
okay.
10 to 3 on Saturdays.
Great.
Right now for our winter hours.
Great. Now, Valentine's Day coming up, and, you know, forget the roses, go right for the chocolate.
I mean, you can add the roses to the chocolate,
you
too.
Could.
We have
you
that
could.
As an option.
You could. Oh, you can eat the rose? Nice.
Well, okay. you can add it. I wouldn't recommend eating it, but you can add it on top.
Well, the Valentine's cupcakes looks like they have a little flower on it that looks like a rose.
Yes, those are roses.
Right, so
that's
can,
an option.
There's your rose.
Yep.
You can get a dozen roses on top of
on
the
top
little
of the cupcakes,
so.
For sure.
That sounds great. 481-3860, the local Artisan Bakery. And good luck to you and all your endeavors. And thank you for being part of the Kingston community. And, you know, it's very exciting. I, you know, despite, you know, the gloom and doom that's out there, I think we all have to be optimistic that things are going to improve, get better. And businesses like this are really is what makes Kingston go and our bigger economy as well. So, all the best to you. Good luck.
Thank you so much for having me.
Say hi to Wisconsin for me.
Will do. Thank
Fran,
you.
Any final words?
No, thanks. Thanks for doing what you do. We're glad that you're there. Thanks for adding to our community.
Thank you, Fran. Good to talk to you again.
You too. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks.
All right, Dan, I think we can take it away. Yep.
Okay, and thank you. Fran DePetrillo, Savoca, and Tony Marmo, and a very, very special thanks to Karianna and Artisan Bakery on Broadway. It's now at the bottom of the hour, and you're with us on Kingston Community Radio, KCR, at AM 920 and 92.5 FM, WGHQ. It's 8:28 a.m., Monday, January 25th, and 14 degrees still here in Uptown Kingston. Because the colors and quality of paint you choose matters, Herzog's Paint and Design Center, located in the Kingston Plaza, is there for you, offering the largest selection of Benjamin Moore paints and the area's most complete line of painting supplies. Herzog's Paint and Design Center also provides color samples from Benjamin Moore paints, including the eco-friendly Aura line. Color decorating consultants and expert interior designers are there, ready to assist you in choosing the right colors and more for your home. Visit Herzog's in the Kingston Plaza. Mid-Hudson Valley weather and forecast one more time. Mostly sunny today, a high of 34. Tonight, mostly cloudy, low down to 21. Tuesday, 90% chance of snow during the day, a high of 29. 1 to 3 inches accumulation expected. Tuesday night, 70% chance of a light snow in the evening, with snow showers continuing overnight with another 1 to 3 inches expected, a low of 28. And Wednesday, mainly cloudy with snow showers around in the morning, 50% chance with a high of 37. And Wednesday night, mainly cloudy with a low around 25. And we'll be right back.
You're listening to Kingston Community Radio on WGHQ Kingston. On your radio at 920 AM and 92.5 FM, and also online at mykcr.org.
The Home Energy Assistance Program can help make winter a little warmer this season, with financial grants to eligible households to help pay heating or utility bills. Are you in need of assistance, or know someone who is? Find out more about the benefits and eligibility requirements of the HEAP program by contacting your County Department of Social Services or by visiting the Assistance Program section of Central Hudson's website, centralhudson.com.
Hey, Dad, your prescription will be ready in just a minute. Hey, Dad, your laundry will be ready in just a minute. Dad, your lunch will be ready in just a minute.
Hey, honey. Why don't you take a minute?
When you help care for a loved one, you give them as much time as you can. But it's just as important to take time for yourself. AARP can help. Find free care guides to support you and your loved one at aarp.org/caregiving. That's aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Dina Roy from Hurley, and I support the Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
And we're back. You're with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. It's Monday, January 25th, and 14 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. WGHQ is 920 on your AM dial, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. And KCR is talk radio. Please call in. 331-9255 is your number. And let's get back to the on-air studio with Tony Marmo and Fran DePetrillo Savoca. Welcome back.
Thanks, Dan, and good morning, folks. This is Marvelous Monday, pro tem. It's just for today. It's Marvelous Monday. Fran, welcome. How are you?
And we're missing Lorraine today. We're missing Lorraine. We hope she'll be back next month.
Yes, yes. And you guys, you two have to come up with a name, you know.
Manic?
A real name.
Manic Monday? Or
Manic Monday.
Or
just
Monday
another
Monday.
Manic Monday.
Monday that, Monday.
Monday Monday.
Yeah.
I like that. A little song deal there, right? That's not bad. And we're joined this half-hour segment by the one, the only, inimitable Raleigh Green.
Good morning. Raleigh Green. Hi, Raleigh.
Hey, Fran. Good morning. It's a happy
Thanks
Monday morning, isn't
in.
It? Tony,
why not? Why not?
Good to see you, Tony. Good to see you, Raleigh. Always, it's great to see you. And you know, why don't you give folks a little background, because you've worn many hats in this town for a few years, and I'd like people to hear about where you're from, how you got to Kingston, you know, because I'm not sure I exactly know that story. So I'm going to learn like the listeners. Who is Raleigh Green?
Oh, well, Raleigh Green, I'm originally from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania.
Oh, okay.
And yes, I did live through Three Mile Island experience. Yeah. That could explain a few things.
Right, that was before masks were prevalent.
So people ask me why I'm paranoid.
Yeah, that's where the light behind the eyes comes from, right?
Oh, great. That's why he's got green eyes now.
Wow. Yes.
Harrisburg, PA.
Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And I wanted to be, ever since 10th grade, an anthropologist.
Ah.
And I did my undergraduate and graduate degree in anthropology.
Okay.
And all I did was write. And I really didn't like writing. Right. So I left early with a master's and then found myself in New York City.
Where would one find a job as an anthropologist? I'm just curious.
Well, back in the time that I went to graduate school, most of the jobs were still in academia.
Okay.
But at that time, it was starting to really become a genuine professional opportunity to go into what's called contract anthropology or contract archaeology, where if you're going to do development anywhere, that all you right. have to go ahead and do make per sure. state and local rules and regulations like to do
secret review.
Exactly, exactly. To do that.
Make sure you're not building on top of a Tyrannosaurus Rex burial ground or something.
Right, that would be more paleontology.
Yeah, okay.
Rather than anthropology, because this has to do with people.
Ah.
But so I fell into New York City, so to speak, and I'd already had some family in the city, so. And I quickly got a job in the world of corporate identity. And instead of studying, observing, and talking about symbols like anthropology does, I got to create it.
Ah, cool.
And which I thought was more rewarding because I have a creative bent to myself.
Right.
And I did that for a number of years and then started my own company, which was a .com mm-hmm. in the late 1990s.
Wow.
I had a staff of 10,
wow.
In the fashion district. It was on, 44th wow. off of 9th. And,
I lived in the city at the time,
New York City. Mm-hmm. And I had great clients, Con Edison, Merck, Unilever, wow. Lipton, KPMG, a lot of different companies. And I sold that interest after the dot-com, lived through 9/11, dot-com recession, all that, and then fell into the world of online marketing for real estate companies.
Interesting.
And which I found very, very interesting until Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers came.
Right. And the bottom dropped out.
So I started another company, which is my company of today, Raleigh Green Inc., and I quickly picked up a number of clients. And at that point, I was visiting Kingston regularly for personal reasons. I had friends up here, and I'd come to escape.
Right.
And so starting in 2005, I was coming up here regularly. Started this company, I decided to move up here permanently. And I started acquiring local businesses. As I was here, I thought I would, most of my clients to start were all around the country. But as I started to spend more time up here, I thought, so my first client up here was Montana Shoes.
Oh, no kidding. Well, that was a quality place there. Sure.
And it just grew from there. And so over the course of some recent clients in the recent past include Dicings, Boyce Brothers, the Kingston Land Trust,
yeah.
City of Kingston Tourism and Arts and Culture, Ulster County Economic Development, the Ulster County Board of Realtors, the Center for Creative Education, Ulster Literacy Association.
Who's who?
And the Best Western, creating the Uptown venue. excuse me, the venue Uptown. And the burning of Kingston is a little side thing that I just love history.
Right, you've embraced that big time. How many of those have you been involved in?
Three, but this year kind of four, because I'm working with Richard Cabanieri, the Rotary Club, and Steve Shallens.
Cattabiani?
Yes.
Yeah.
And some others. We created a new event called the Capital to Capital Run.
Yes, I'm very familiar with it.
And which...
Being a good Rotarian than I am.
Good, right. Yes. So so that's been something I'm really interested in. I have a passion for history, anything about history. And so I'm fascinated by local history. And I'm on the Hurley Heritage Society board as well.
Very active.
And
Fran, I'm sure you have like a million questions for Raleigh.
Well, my first one is, what year did you decide to stay permanently here?
2009. Oh, very nice. Actually, you could answer this question. When did Hurricane Irene hit? What year was that? Was that 2010?
Let's see.
2010. Summer of August of 2010.
Because the other one was 2012, wasn't it? The next one, the other bad one we had. That was, I remember.
Yeah, I'm
that.
Pretty sure it was August of 2010. I don't think it was 2009.
So the reason I bring Irene up, it was 2010. Mm-hmm. I had been coming up, and I was actually living long chunks of time up here. But then I got stuck up here. I couldn't go back to the city because of Hurricane Irene, because the thruway was out and most of the ways back were closed off. And so I needed to just spend some time doing something. And so I started looking at apartments up here just to see if I could find a pied-à-terre. And I just was blown away by how much space you could get and what kind of views and everything. You know, compared to New York City, what I was paying, it was much, much better. And I found something that just blew me away, and I had to have it. And at that point, my clients were all around the country mostly, and so I could be anywhere.
Right.
And I pulled the trigger, and I rented for a couple years, and then I bought something eventually in Hurley. Hmm. But I consider Kingston as kind of my home plate.
Yeah.
At this point, since much of my clientele is now in the Kingston area, and I play in Kingston, as you know.
Right. Now, Fran, you must have worked with Raleigh as well, right? I mean, on several projects, tourism, chamber.
Yeah, sometimes. I'm trying to think. I must have volunteered for the event you did with Boyce Brothers Dairy for their 100th anniversary.
The longest ice cream sundae in the world.
And
I don't want to speak out of turn, but they had their record beaten, and they're thinking about maybe coming back.
Okay.
Ooh, all right. Very nice. Count me in if it happens again.
Yeah.
And yes, Raleigh and I have worked together like through numerous different capacities, because Raleigh's been a chamber member for a very long time, but also I sat on Raleigh's committee for the Burning of Kingston events once I came over to tourism. So that's been an interesting progression to watch, and it was a lot of work on Raleigh's plate for that to be pulled off every other year. And then it was very smart on Raleigh's part to add the alternative year something so that people didn't forget the Burning of Kingston on the off year. So
that's great.
Hence Capital Run.
Capital Run. I really actually it was a bit boosterism on the Hurley part, because there is a storyline that Hurley has to the Burning of Kingston storyline, welcoming the refugees.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time of the idea of the Capital Run, concerns about refugees was pretty much top of mind for many. So it was a way to frame the subject in an interesting way, a very local way.
Mm-hmm.
And it worked out. We had a for It was not planned as a virtual run, but it ended up being
because of the.
We had a great turnout for the first time ever, and I was just talking to Richard about this year, what we're going to do, virtual or in person. It's going to happen, so I'm very excited. That will be in October.
October, okay, right.
I think October 17th on Sunday, but I'm not 100% sure yet on that to confirm.
Get on the Italian weekend there. Make sure you stay away from that one.
Yeah.
Which is, well, that's O positive as well. At least historically, it was O positive.
Fran and I have worked, collaborated in many ways, and Fran, both at the chamber and at tourism.
You
have been wonderful to work with because you're so helpful and thoughtful, and you really do a great job. So,
Well, I really appreciate that, Raleigh. It's been great working with you. Mutual admiration there, because it's been great working with you. And it feels like it's been longer than it has. And I gave false information. Hurricane Irene was August of 2011, actually.
Okay. Well, and then Sandy, I think, was it Sandy the next one? No, Sandy was in 12.
Sandy was next,
The next
that was October 2012. I remember that because I was running a nursing home down in New Jersey, and the only place we could get gas was up here. So I would fill my pickup truck with, that's a really smart idea, right? 5-gallon gas cans, because our staff couldn't get gas. You know, all the Jersey gas stations were shut down. So anyway, tell us, give us the Raleigh Green viewpoint of, the pandemic and where we're at and how we're going to come out of this thing. Everyone goes on, when we have these shows, we ask people for predictions and then we go back and look at them down the road.
Buy gold.
Buy gold. All right, this is not a financial show, but we could turn it into that. right.
Plastics.
Yeah, plastics, right? Gold plastics. What are you thinking?
My profession, of course, is advertising and marketing, and so I can speak. I feel a little more comfortable speaking to prognostications.
Right.
And on that front, I think advertising has been significantly changed in terms of how it's conducted, where businesses, what kind of media mixes they invest in, what kind of results they expect, how to capture people where they're most likely to be persuaded or engaged.
Do you think these are permanent changes that when the world does return to normalcy, when in 2022, that's my prediction, will some of these changes that you allude to be permanent, or do you think we'll drift back to the good old days?
Well, I've been having some interesting conversations with some smart people locally on this subject. For example, is the migration of all these New York City folks who've moved to the Hudson Valley a permanent trend? Mm-hmm. And once this is, as you say, return to normal, whatever that may be,
right?
Will they go back? So there's a number of different things happening while this pandemic has hit and the economic repercussions. One big one that a lot of people don't talk about is that the millennial population is as big, if not bigger, than the baby boomers. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people have made fun of millennials living at their parents' home into their 30s. Well, that's changed. They've grown up and they've been buying homes, their starter homes, their first new homes, right, and they're and having children.
Right.
So they need space.
A couple of those little creeps. Right. No, they're great kids. They really are. I got to stop talking to them in the negative. Yeah, go ahead.
They are looking at options where they want to live. And with this pandemic, people have wanted, for various reasons, to move out into the suburbs, leave the city. The heart of the city is moving. So you have communities all throughout the Hudson Valley being seen as very, very attractive. And this is happening not just in New York. This is happening all across the country. I've spoken to people you know, I was just speaking to the owner of Kingston Consignments, who has family in Madison, Wisconsin. And the same thing's happening, he said, right there. And I know this for a fact that this is happening in California and in Washington, D.C., and in other major metropolitan areas. There's a flight outside of the city because people want more space and the less fear of, I guess, a pandemic exposure. So that's driving a lot of
decisions making.
So that's affecting advertising. Where can you capture these people, all right? And how do you capture them when they're moving from one place to another and then they're now newbies in that community? For example, in our community here in Kingston, we're finding a rapid growth of new residents.
Mostly from metropolitan New York.
From metropolitan New York. Not all of them, but a lot of them. And that's creating some interesting dynamics and questions being asked to businesses. Very practical decisions or questions. If you're a family-owned company that's been around for a long time and you have an existing client base, loyal client base.
Like the Nacarados.
Yes, they are a client of mine
for
many years, and they're wonderful. They're a wonderful company. The question then becomes, how can we capture the new clientele without alienating the old clientele? Can that be done, and how does that get done? And so that you can prosper, and this is a delicate balance because the thinking of the new residents may not conform to, you know, what has been there, and this is interesting for me as a as a former anthropologist.
How does
this play out in terms of society, and so in terms of execution?
Of
strategy for advertising. It's a fascinating read.
Oh, it is. It absolutely is. So I didn't realize there were 72 million millennials. I thought the baby boomers were pretty much the biggest number, but the baby boomers are like right next to them with 71.6 million, and they're 72.1. But the baby boomers are going to start croaking off. We know that.
Yeah.
But the new buyers, as you're pointing out, potentially are this millennial group, and they grew up with electronics much more than we did. So I think they're more used to looking at. Although it's hilarious. My soon-to-be 39-year-old son is not on Facebook. He's not on Instagram. The other one does, but not as much. I'm not sure why the 39-year-old has never gotten to social media. So he's an interesting guy because he's the last kid that probably read a newspaper in my house. You know,
the interesting thing is circling back to marketing in a pandemic,
advertising
in a pandemic, is that it's gotten more complicated and challenging. All right. As I mentioned, there are very dynamic market changes going on.
Right.
Because there's actually demographic changes going on. People moving, people going, et cetera. And that changes their interests, what they're interested in, and the kinds of messages that may appeal to them. Are you getting these new people as customers, and what's going to be the right message that's going to appeal to them? You know, without alienating your existing days, because they may or may not have the same interests.
Right.
All right.
That's
at least outlook.
Very good point.
The next is not everything is going digital. What's happened is that early on the pandemic, everyone started throwing tons of money at digital, social media, ad servers, Google AdWords, et cetera. What's ended up happening is where those areas used to be cost-effective solutions, they've gotten expensive. So they're not quite as easy pickings for those with tight budgets.
Right.
So you have to get more creative.
Right.
What's happened is that Interestingly enough, one of my new clients is called the Kingston Wire, which is a new digital news publication that's focused on Kingston, covering it's an independent news and views for Kingston with established journalists, and it's doing great. And but they also, the company that owns the Kingston Wire also owns the Shawangunk Journal, which is a printed publication. And while the initial pandemic hit them hard, their subscribership has actually been growing. Because what's happened, and I'm hearing this in other places, this has happened even with the Freeman, is that print subscribership, people like to get that now because it's delivered home. You can easily pick it up, all right? And it gives them something to do. Right. Now, and there's a big difference between digital and print. With digital, you have a less chance of what I call serendipitous exploration, where you just kind of, if unlike a paper online, you're going from website to website to website to website.
Right.
All right. There's sometimes prompts, but with print, you open up a print paper, and you see ads and articles all at once, and so your eye just kind of grazes over and reads something or sees something that you may not have done otherwise. Serendipity.
Yeah.
And some people really like that, especially those who are new to a community.
Right, right.
So instead of getting siloed by being only online, some people like to open up a paper and graze over it to get a feel for the community at large.
Yeah.
And there's true. So there's been growth in some of these print publications in certain quarters. Understand, I say this, but with the big, huge caveat that all print publications have been decimated over the last, this has happened for the last 10 years.
Oh, yeah, right.
But over the last, after the last 9 months, they've been, most of them have been very much hurting. But so, some are not.
So how do you see us coming out? We only have a few minutes left, I think. How do you see us coming out of this into 21, you know, as we're... And then into 22, what are you predicting?
In terms of advertising, I think that we're going to find a new balance between the traditional and new or digital marketing. It will be companies will be compelled to have a more diverse media mix for advertising, and it will become much more targeted, blasting out ads to the general public with no targeted or advertising or metrics, I think will be increasingly rare. I think that
22, these things, do they stay around or do we slip back?
I don't think we're going to slip back anywhere where we used to be. I think that the changes are going to become permanent because, as we were talking about the millennials and then the Zers, they live this stuff.
Yeah, right.
To them, this is not new.
Yeah.
And so, you know, time's on their side.
Yeah.
I'm an Xer. So yeah. Time's on their side.
Yeah. I'm a boomer. Time's not on my side. But I think that's fascinating, Raleigh. Thank you so much for coming in and sharing. We'll have to get you back on one of the shows on KCR. I think it's important information for us to consider and. It is a changing world, but, I think there's still some something that binds us all together. You know, that's this community, I think. And how we do our business now is changing, but how we watch out for each other shouldn't change.
Absolutely. Right? I agree with you 100%. It's a wonderful community.
It is.
And thank you for having me on,
Tony.
And thank you, Fran, for having me on as well.
Yes, Raleigh, thanks for coming in, and we're working on a committee currently together about this whole topic of print and digital, so I'll be talking to you this week.
Yes.
There you go. that's great. Dan, how are we doing time-wise?
Oh, you've got a couple minutes, maybe there's a couple items to finish up with Raleigh. I'm not sure.
Yeah, go ahead, sure.
One thing I wanted to mention that I did... this past summer is trying you know, the business community, not all of it. There are certain sectors that are doing fine. For example, residential real estate is doing fine.
Right.
Okay.
Sure.
And anything connected to it. But other industries, especially retail, are suffering a lot.
Yes.
And since our local community is very much heavily dependent upon the retail sector, including restaurants, that plus hospitality, the idea of championing those businesses in some way, I felt compelled to do something, do something. So back in April, I was wandering, walking my dogs uptown Kingston, and it was as quiet as a mouse. In the middle of the day, I thought, well, someone needs to say something that these businesses will be open. It's not a question of when. It was a question of when will they be open. Yeah. So I worked with Kingston Uptown Business Association and Ulster Savings Bank. Savings, I went to Ulster Savings and asked them for a budget.
Okay.
And they said yes. And I got Cuba to help be the platform upon which a campaign was launched. And we created Uptown Kingston is Open. And ran that. And that hit right at the beginning of July when things were allowed to reopen per the governor. And it ran for a couple months, and it really, really helped.
Yeah.
Something like that should probably be considered maybe even larger for the whole city
or
for the area, because I think a lot of people don't even know that businesses are open. A lot of people are still at home.
You know,
and they don't know the best protocol, or they're not. People like to be invited. It's funny, but people like to be invited.
That's true.
Talk to me. So that's something that campaign worked out pretty well, and that was something that I thought was quite fun to do this summer.
Great. We got to move on. Thank you, Raleigh Green. Raleigh Green, Inc. Website for you, or how contact?
RaleighGreenInc.com.
There you go.
Is the best place to find me. Raleigh Green, Inc. That's R-A-L-E-I-G-H, like in the city, and green as in the color, and ink as in incorporated.
No K. See. All right. Dan Gatiss, thank you so much. Fran, thank you so much for being on, and you and I'll speak soon.
Yes, thanks for having
everybody
me.
Be
Have
safe.
A great day, y'all. Thanks for coming in, Raleigh.
Thank you.
Go help someone. Be kind. Go out and love somebody up, and make sure they're doing okay. Give a friend a call. Make sure they're doing all right.
Monday.
That's it.
Thank you, Tony, and a very, very special thanks. Bye-bye, Fran. We'll see you. And a very, very special thanks to our guests, John Quigley, Raleigh Green, and Karianna Haasch from our local area here. And you have been listening to Kingston Community Radio, and we thank you for that. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Many locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, locations near you. And until tomorrow at 7 a.m., we wish you every success in growing and developing Kingston and all our neighboring communities. We now return you to Real Country Radio.
Land of the free, home of the legends. Real country, all the time.
Was he woman on a